Good morning.
Good morning.
Christ the Lord has risen. He has risen indeed. Welcome. We are so glad you are here with us this morning in our time of worship on this Easter Sunday morning, 2022. We want to welcome all of you, especially those of you who are visiting with us today. And a special word of welcome to those who will be joining us later online. We welcome you as well. We hope you find today's service a meaningful service of both word and sacrament. As a reminder, in the United Methodist tradition, our table is an open table. And Jesus, our host, invites all who wish to partake to come forward when we partake of the Holy Supper here in a little while. Are there any announcements any of you have before we begin? I want to call your attention to just a couple things. One, reminder that a charge conference has been scheduled for May 4th on a Wednesday here at 7 p.m. The purpose of the meeting is, of course, is to consider the purchase of the adjacent building next to the thrift store and in the investment of funds into the Cheyenne County Community Foundation. And those will be the two main points of business at that meeting. As a reminder, charge conference is for all of those who are on the administrative council. They will be the ones voting on those two issues. However, a charge conference is open to anyone who is a member of this church. And so even if you're not on the charge or administrative council, you still are welcome if you are a member to attend that meeting that night. Also, just be aware that I will be on vacation this week, and so we will not have any Tuesday morning Bible study, nor will there be any Wednesday morning UMW Bible study either this week. So just be aware of that. If you have any emergencies of any sort, pastoral emergencies, please call Julie at the office. If there's no other announcements, I would invite you at this time to stand as you are able and join with me in our call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. The stone rejected by the builders has now become the cornerstone. This is the day the Lord has made.
We will
rejoice and be glad. Our hymn of praise is number 302, and we'll sing verses 1 through 4.
Thank you.
be seated. And at this time, if I could have all of the kids come down for our children's message, and if you would all just gather right here, just find a place and sit right in here in this area. This is quite a group, and it's so good to see all of you here today. What is today?
Easter.
Easter. And why do we celebrate and observe Easter? Why do we celebrate or observe Easter? Yes. Yes, it's today that Christ rose over death. It's today that we celebrate and remember when Jesus rose from the tomb. Now, I have another trick for you today, and it should work today. Unlike for those of you who remember here a few weeks ago, we tried a trick. It didn't work out as well, but hopefully this one will. What I have here is just a regular deck of cards. Now, this card is the King of Hearts, okay? And the reason why I show you this is, first of all, there's only one King of Hearts in one deck of playing cards. So there's no other cards like this in this deck of cards. And as you can see, this is just a regular deck of playing cards. There's nothing magical about them. They're just a regular deck of playing cards. Now, why I chose the King of Hearts is because, first and foremost, Jesus is like our King, isn't he? He's our King. He's our King of Hearts because everything that he did was because he loved us. And so that's why I think the King of Hearts is important. So what I'm going to do is, remember, this is the only card, the King of Hearts in the whole deck. I'm going to take this card and I'm just going to simply put it in here in the bottom. And this deck of cards, let's just pretend it's like the grave, okay? This is the grave that Jesus went into. So I just put Jesus in the grave, okay, in the tomb. And because today is Easter, Jesus rises from the tomb, doesn't he? He rises from the bottom up out to the top of the tomb. And he rises up, and there he is. He rose to the top. He rose to the top. We are here because, again, yes, today is the day we celebrate and remember when Jesus victored or won over death. He rose from the grave, and he did all this because he wanted to show how much he loves us. Jesus fought death, and he won. And because of him, we are forgiven, we are loved by God, and most importantly, when our time comes, we will rise too, because Jesus brought and made resurrection what was once thought impossible as being possible. And that's the hope you and I live in our lives. But most importantly, in our lives today, we need to remember that Jesus is love. And he did all of this because he loves us. Okay? Yeah, did you have something or anybody? Okay. Well, will you join with me in this prayer? Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for always loving us. And thank you for not only your love, but your life and your giving of that life on the cross. Help us to never forget of your sacrifice for all God's people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, if you want to hold on just a second, we should have enough treats for everybody. to me, I think this is too many kids to handle. Well, maybe it is, but it's a problem I'd like to have every Sunday. Nevertheless, we have been given much to be thankful for, and therefore, as a sign of our thankfulness, let us receive our morning offering. Join with me in our offertory prayer. Let us pray. Mighty God of resurrection power, we offer us life that overcomes death, light that overcomes darkness, hope that overcomes our deepest despair. What response could we offer? As in gifts, and yes, but our minds, hearts, bodies, and witnesses. May our minds be about understanding who you are and who you long for us to be in this world.
May our hearts overflow with your love and compassion for the poor, the oppressed, and the forgotten. May our bodies carry us out of the tombs of isolation to engage our neighbors, sisters, and brothers. May our witness be the alleluias we take with us to bring hope to everyone we meet. In the risen Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And we have come now to a time of sharing our joys and concerns. What joys or concerns do you have this morning? Yes. Thank you, Pat. Are there other joys or concerns? Yes, Tom.
I guess this is a joy for pleased to have our son Jim and Melissa and their family with us, and they brought two friends from Denver to celebrate Easter weekend with us, and it's Andrew and Paula. And the other couple, their daughter was
thank you, Tom, and welcome to all of you. We're so glad you're here with us. And as our tradition, in a few moments, I'll invite you up to make a 10-minute speech. I'm just kidding. If that doesn't make you crawl away, I don't know what will, but we welcome you. We're glad you're here. And again, any of our visitors who are with us this morning, we are so glad you are here with us. As many of you know, Cade and Aspen had their baby, Boston, a few months early last week, but the last update I got is that Boston is doing quite well. I was told that they have to kind of keep him restrained because they don't want him moving around a lot. They don't want him expending a lot of energy. The doctor doesn't want him losing any more weight than what's necessary. But it sounds like he's doing really well. And one of the unique things about it is the only one who's touched that he likes to have is his dad's. Anybody else that tries to touch or hold him, he doesn't seem to like. But for some reason, he does like it when dad touches and holds him. So we want to pray for all of them. It's going to be a long haul for them, too. They're going to be there at least through probably July. So we want to pray for them during this time. We also want to pray for the family of Eileen Riley. Eileen passed away earlier this week, and her services were here yesterday. So we want to pray for her family for comfort and strength during this time as well. We also, as a joy, want to congratulate Michaela and Lewin Norris, who were married this past week. We congratulate both of them. And at this time, I ask you to join with me in our time of prayer. And as our tradition here is as I offer each prayer petition, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and your response will be, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Father,
We come together today to celebrate the holiest day, perhaps, of our entire year as your people, the day that Jesus rose from the grave. We come together acknowledging life beyond death, all made possible because of the risen Christ. And Lord, we thank you for your great love shown to us in Jesus Christ, that we are redeemed by him and through him, Lord, and that we share in that same promise now, not only redeemed, but loved and forgiven. Lord, let us remember and celebrate this great day together as your people, that we might be agents of that same love and mercy to show one another. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we have not always, though, done your will, and at times we've fallen short of your glory. We've turned our backs on those in need, Lord. So, Lord, we humbly come before you today asking for your forgiveness. Forgive us, we pray, of our waywardness. Help us to once again know of your love and grace, to experience that love and grace from you, O Lord, that our sinfulness, we are forgiven. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are given new life, O Lord, to grow in that same love, to become agents of that love and grace to one another. And Lord, let that love and grace flow freely through us all. That not only are we agents, but that we too may forgive one another just as we have been forgiven. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we lift up all of those who are ill or hospitalized. We lift up all of the, you know their names, Lord, and we lift them all to you. And we just pray for wholeness, for restoration, healing, and strength to be upon them. Be with the doctors, specialists, nurses, aides, and all others who tend to their care. Grant them, O Lord, healing. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, while this day is a day of resurrection, of new life, we know many in our community who are grieving. And Lord, it is for them we pray, and especially the Riley family, and we ask just that, Lord, you uplift them and uphold them during their time of grief. And for all others, Lord, who grieve in any way, for the passing of loved ones, both in the last year and beyond, we pray, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray a special prayer today for the Bracelin family, for Boston and his parents and all who are coming to know and love him. And we just pray that you be with all of them during this time, the doctors, nurses, and others who are tending to his care. Lord, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we also lift up today those people amongst us that we know who have the hope to become parents, but for whatever reason have not been able to. And Lord, we pray for them today too, and we remember them. For their pain is just as real too, Lord, and their grief. And we pray for them and ask, Lord, for your blessing and for your healing to comfort them too, Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father, we lift up again the people of Ukraine, and Lord, we just pray for peace there and for all other places around this world where there is turmoil, where there is bloodshed and violence. Lord, we pray for your will to be with the leaders of countries all around this world, that they may find a pathway to peace, and that the endless violence that we hear coming out of places like in Ukraine and in the Middle East and in Africa and even here in our own part of the world, Lord, that may one day come to an end and soon.
Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for family and friends who may be traveling this weekend, and we just ask for you to watch over, to guide and bless them, and Lord, ensure them safe travel to and from their destinations. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we ask and we pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first scripture reading is taken from Acts chapter 10, beginning with verse 34. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know that the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth by the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Our second reading is from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, found in chapter 15, beginning with verse 19. If this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For all of us die in Adam, so that all will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order, Christ the firstfruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. A reading from the Holy Gospel of John, found in chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. She ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple to whom Jesus loved and said to him, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him."
Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrapping lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have been carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned around and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. May Almighty God bless to our hearts and minds this an understanding of God's holy word. This is the word of the Lord. Now, just a quick note, we had a little mix up. Communion and the communion hymn will follow the sermon. For right now, as we normally do at this time, we will sing our next hymn, number 318.
Thank you.
Please pray for me as I pray for you as we think and reflect upon our scripture passages together. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and may the meditation in all of our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our refuge, a very present help in trouble. Amen. Well, this morning, as we hear from these words in John, we hear of Jesus' first appearance after the resurrection to Mary Magdalene, to Simon Peter, and the beloved disciple. And as we heard that Mary Magdalene was the first one to come to the tomb, she came to that tomb expecting to see the tomb sealed, and at very least to at least know that Jesus' body laid in that tomb. But when she got there, that's not what she found. She found that the stone that had been used to seal the tomb had been removed. And when she looked in, the tomb was empty. I can only imagine the emotion that she was feeling during that time. Probably overwhelmed already with grief, knowing what happened to Jesus and witnessing such a cruel, horrible death that day, 3 days earlier. And now to come to the tomb to maybe at least get a little comfort, to be near the body and to find now that the body itself is missing. The tomb is empty. So she turns and she runs with all of her might to go back and tell others. And two of the ones she tells, of course, are Simon Peter and the beloved disciple. I can only imagine the urgency that she had as she ran back to tell others what was on her mind and what she was thinking, and probably just trying to get back in a hurry to tell others what she saw. I don't think my experience this morning was probably the same thing, but I will tell you, I woke up early this morning and got ready to head out to the cemetery about 6:30 or so, and I headed out there and got set up and thought to myself, well, I have a few moments. I can just sit here in the cab of my pickup and enjoy the sunrise and have some coffee and just relax until the service starts. But as I sat there and as I looked down at my watch, it was just about 7 o'clock, and of course the service was set to begin at 7:15. Nobody had yet arrived, but as I sat there, I realized I didn't bring copies of the two hymns that I wanted us to sing. And I thought for a moment, oh, we can do without them. And then I thought, no, it just wouldn't be an Easter sunrise service if we at least didn't sing one or two hymns. And so I hurried back into town with urgency to get those hymns that I left laying on the chair at home. But as I did, I couldn't help but think for a moment what it must have been like for Mary Magdalene to come back with the news that she had. And I'm sure it was with a greater sense of urgency than what I had this morning. But see, that's it. I thought about, you know, myself trying to identify a little bit with Mary Magdalene, to think of the grief that she had. And, you know, I think about this entire past week, and if you been with us through any of the special services we've had this week, we've heard more than a lot about the passion narrative. We've heard the different interpretations from Luke and Matthew. I remember some years ago at a church that I was serving as a student pastor getting through Holy Week. And I can remember at the end of the week, as church was coming to a close that Easter Sunday, I remember somebody saying to me, "You sure talk a lot about death and resurrection this week, didn't you?" Well, yes, we have. This past week, we've talked a lot about the death of Jesus, and we've talked and heard the stories of the many different characters who were part of what we call the passion narrative. From all of the disciples, the ones who were closest to Jesus, who were supposed to be his friends, to the others who mocked him, who added to the cruelty and pain of his death, the guards, the chief priests and the scribes and others who stood that day at the foot of the cross, made fun of him, giving him sour wine to drink. And then you take his closest friends who were supposed to be there and support him, to love him just as much as he loved him. And even the night before, when he expressed to him that he knew that before this was all said and done with, one of them would deny him, not once, not twice, but three times. And even worse yet, one of them, a friend whom all believe loved Jesus just as much as anybody else, saw an opportunity to enrich himself and would betray Jesus. And then we think of those others who loved Jesus and maybe themselves had experienced a miracle of healing from him in his ministry, who gathered that day on that hill but from a distance, who watched with grief and pain but didn't want to get too close. The point of all of this is I think no matter what we listen and what version of the narrative we listen to, we all find ourselves to some degree sort of sympathizing and relating to certain characters and others we don't. But the truth of the matter is, I think there's a little bit of each of those characters in each of us. From the women and others who tenderly watched in a distance in grief, who wailed and beat their breasts, as we were told, after the crucifixion, after Jesus died. Or maybe we're the ones that say we're close to Jesus, but when it comes down to it, when it really matters, we choose to flee and run away. And maybe for some of us, we're like Judas. We find the place where we can ultimately betray Jesus. Or maybe we're some of that guard that added to the cruelty that day, mocking him and saying, if you really are who you are, then do as you say and prove it to us. Or maybe we're like one of the criminals who was on each side of him that day. Maybe we're the one who looks to Jesus and pleads with him, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus looks to us and says, in that pain, truly I tell you, you will be with me in paradise. Or maybe we're like the criminal on the other side who ignores all of that and continues to mock and make fun of Jesus and add to the pain and misery. Point of the matter is we all in some way, I think, can relate to many of these characters that we hear in the Passion narrative. And we can relate to some of those that we hear today in the story of those who first he appeared to, including Mary Magdalene and Simon Peter and the beloved disciple. What we do know this is that for Mary Magdalene, she went to the tomb, saw that it was empty, went back to tell others, and then came back. And though Simon Peter and the other disciples saw, Simon Peter wasn't quite sure what to believe. The beloved disciple looked in and knew exactly what happened. But the point of the matter is, these two men turned and left right away. They went back to their homes. Mary Magdalene continued to sit there in the darkness and in her grief yet, still not quite sure 100% what happened, other than to know that the body of her Lord was now missing. And she sat in that darkness for a while. And you see, that's what a lesson we can learn today from. Because there's been no doubt many of us this past year, 2 years even, have been through some darkness. This church and this community has seen a lot of heartbreak, especially over this past year. The truth of the matter is sometimes we have to sit and be in that heartbreak, to be in that grief. To sit and be in the darkness like Mary did that day. But to know that darkness will not have the final say. That darkness will give way to everlasting light. Everlasting light and love and hope. Because that is the promise Jesus has made to you and I. He made known in the last words of the Last Supper that he held with his beloved disciples. Even feeding those that he knew would well abandon him and betray him, but he fed them anyway because he loved them. And when darkness creeps up on us, sometimes all we can do is sit there and be with it. But no, like with Mary Magdalene, the voice of Jesus will come calling. Mary didn't recognize him necessarily by sight that morning, but when he spoke, she had no doubt that it was Jesus. I don't know how many of you have ever been in that position to hear when someone speaks. Maybe you can't recognize them by sight, but just to hear their voice. As some of you know, a couple weeks ago, I went back to Nebraska to go attend a funeral of a former coworker of mine. And while I was there, my older brother, Russell, who is my father's oldest biological son, invited me out to dinner that night at the Methodist church that he and his family attend there in Hay Springs, Nebraska. And I remember as I walked into the church hall that night, as I walked in, there were quite a few people there. And I looked around and I couldn't see my brother or his family right away. But as I stood in line, I heard him laugh. You see, one thing about my brother Russ is his laugh is a lot like my dad's was. And when I heard him laugh, I had no doubt then that I knew he was there. And for Mary Magdalene that morning, when Jesus simply called out to her and said, "Mary," she knew he was there. And suddenly the darkness, that the sadness she was in, gave way to great light. And that's the hope that we live in today. While we've experienced darkness, grief, and sadness over these past several months, we know that resurrection, that light comes. How soon, we have to just sit and wait sometimes. And as I've shared, one final thing. In this whole pandemic, the last 2 years, I come to know what that darkness was like. Not just in my own journey of grief that I experienced, but what I remember is 2 years ago in Easter 2020, when we were at the height during the first wave of the pandemic. And Easter Sunday rolled around that morning, and the church I was serving at in Nebraska, I remember going over there that morning, and what should have been a morning where the pews would be filled like they are here this morning, that we'd have more than enough children that we could handle in the front for the children's message, while that should have been, it wasn't. For Easter service that morning, instead of preaching to a packed full of church, I preached to an empty, dark church. And all I had was my laptop and my webcam and a microphone. And that's how I preached that year's Easter message, in a darkened sanctuary with nobody else there. It helped me really understand the darkness that the people we read about, like Mary and others, experienced.
But it also helped me understand the darkness we sometimes experience ourselves. But that sometimes we have to just sit and be with it. But you know what? Again, that darkness doesn't have the last say. As I stand here today and look out over so many of you and see so many kids today, it gives me great hope again of the resurrection promise that you and I live in. So brothers and sisters, whether your path is light right now or darkness, know that there always lies just around the corner the lightness, the hope, and the love found in the resurrection that promises you and I new life. So may you live in that light, in that hope, and in that love of the eternal Jesus. Christ the Lord has risen. He has risen indeed. Amen. I invite you now to join in singing our communion hymn number 618. We'll sing the first three verses. I invite you to turn to page 13 in the front of your hymnals. And will you please join me in our communion liturgy through the words of the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is a right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. From the earth you formed forth bread and created the fruits of the vine. You formed us in your image, delivered us from captivity, and made covenant to be our sovereign God. You fed us manna in the wilderness and gave grapes as evidence of the promised land. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God of power and might, full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When we turned aside from your way and abused your gifts, you gave us in him your crowning gift, empowering himself that our joy might be full. He fed the hungry, healed the sick, also with the scorned and forgotten, washed his disciples' feet and gave them a holy meal. Lord, we thank you for this sacrifice. And once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night that Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, and said, "This bread I give to you, do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, in the same manner, after the supper had ended, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant poured in my blood for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." And in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And at this time, I invite those who are helping serve communion to come forward. As you come forward, please come forward by coming down the center aisle and then return to your pews on the outside aisles. When everyone has been served here in the main part of the sanctuary, this group will go over here and serve all of you. And then anybody, for whatever reason, who's unable to come forward at that time, if you just raise your hand and a couple of the servers will come to you then if you need us to. Come now and receive these gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. go this morning, I just also forgot to say thank you to all of you, especially last week, who came and showed up and supported the Ukraine benefit dinner we had up at the high school. If you haven't heard, we raised a little over $9,400. And in the weeks in getting ready for this, in preparing the food, originally we were told to let's think about maybe trying to feed about 500 people. Well, we thought, some of us that were involved, that maybe was a little too optimistic. And if we got half of that, we'd consider it a good dinner. The truth of the matter is based on the number of plates that were used that day, we estimate approximately 460 people were fed, both dine-in and takeout. And so thank you to all of you who came out to eat, who helped in any way, to Travis, who did the meat, and I know spent a lot of long hours getting ready and watching over it as he smoked it. It was a delicious meal. So I can't say thank you to so many of you who helped. We are blessed to live in such a generous, caring, loving community. And so thank you again on behalf of the Ministerial Alliance for all of your support in this. We were able to give the money directly to Samaritan's Purse, as they had a representative on site last week. So we were able to present them a check for that amount. And so thank you again, and know that your donations go directly to help support the people in Ukraine. As you are able, I invite you to please stand. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. We will join in singing our next hymn, our closing hymn, and we'll sing just the first verse. Thank you.